this sounds so good. Hey guys, it's Dagan from PMTV UK. And what I have with me today is something very, very cool and close to my heart. With Motley Crue's biopic movie, The Dirt, coming out, I was asked out of the blue by our media content director guy, going, he's Australian, so I'm not gonna try the accent. He was like, do you fancy doing a Motley Crue, how to get the sound, how does Mick get his sound kind of thing? And I replied with this email on the screen right now. Now, obviously, I can't get Mick's rig. If you look at pictures of Mick's rig, you'll see he's got huge refrigerators full of rack mount gear. Everything is accumulated from back in the 80s. So, this isn't kind of like a sounds like a how to do Mick Mars's tone on a budget. I will give you some budget options later on. It's kind of just, can you get that sound without being Mick Mars? And I'm trying my best to with these Marshalls, which I'll get into in a minute, and an assortment of lovely guitars. If you don't know who Motley Crue are, why are you watching this? They're one of the best bands there's ever been. I play a lot of bluesy kind of rocky guitar these days, but if I hear Motley Crue in a bar, or if I have it on in the house, I will immediately start drinking and not finish until the entire discography is finished. They're my favorite band of all time, and Mick Mars is one of the greatest, most underrated players of all time. But there's not really any videos of what gear he used, how he gets his sound, and what you can kind of get these days to replicate that sound on a budget or not. So I'm here today to talk you through all the fun things I can. Mick's sound was very consistent, well, after the first Motley Crue album, Too Fast for Love, up until, well, quite recently, like the new Tattoo album and Saints of Los Angeles got very thick and very, very beefy. Before then, it was certainly thick and beefy. It's kind of like he's got a very chainsaw-y kind of guitar sound on this first album. There's a lot of low end, but it's very, very intense. We'll get to albums like Dr. Feelgood in a bit, where that's just wizardry to make it sound that good. I don't know how he pulled it off live. There might be backing tracks, I'm not too sure. Amp-wise, which I'll get to in a moment in a bit more detail, when we start with Too Fast for Love. Marshalls. Obviously Marshalls, it's gotta be Marshalls. Amazing things. Mick was big on his EL34s, I should say, so I've chose to use J700 and the Astoria Custom. EQ-wise, everything here is about 1 o'clock. The gain is 3/4 of the way up. Presence quite low. On this guy, everything's pretty much 1 o'clock. The gain's at 1 o'clock. There's a boost function on this, which I'm not using. Everything's just getting pushed slightly further. I've read loads of things from people back in the 80s, guitarists in the 80s, saying, to get a good sound with the Marshall, if it's hot rodded or not, put everything at noon and tweak from there. Don't go with the sounds, I like a bright amp, I'm gonna turn the gain up, I'll turn the treble up. Start with everything at noon and then tweak accordingly for the room, the guitar, and everything. I've gotta say, before I go any further, before we get into this lovely little medley of Motley Crue albums and gear, the reason Mick, well, and Nicky get such a good, deep, crunchy sound is that they tune their guitars a whole step down. So it's D, G, C, F, A, D on his lovely guitars and on Nicky's Thunderbirds, Spectres, and Schecters. He's a long advocate of Ernie Ball strings as well. He used to use 10s, if you look on the old vintage guitar article he did, and some stuff, I think a Premier guitar and stuff, but on his recent Ernie Ball Paradigm documentary, he uses the Paradigms 11-52 and 11-54. Tuned a whole step down. He's been an early Ernie Ball user for years, so he says. Pick-wise, I think he uses 0.88. I've held one before, one of the ones that said pimp on it, like it says on the back of a Strat, and I think it was a 0.88. Let me know down below in the comments what pick Mick uses, and if you've got one, because I'll probably want to buy it off it with one of my legs or something. The amps have always been the same. He's very much a Marshall dude, and these days if you see pictures of his house, he's got Marshalls covering his entire living room and whatnot. But they've kind of evolved over the years. He's added things, he's taken things away, he's modded them, he's slaved them into other things, which I'll get to when the albums come. But for now, let's go right back to the start. Too Fast for Love album, 1981. So, the Too Fast for Love album, 1981. Well, 1982, if you discount the fact that they brought it out on their own label. Mick was using Marshalls. Hot rodded Marshalls. What I have to my left Or to your right is the JSM 800 Studio, underneath Mick's lovely hat, the new, smaller JSM 800. I could have used 100 watt, but there's not a lot of room in this corner, and this gives you exactly the same sound as the 100 watt, but for a bit smaller. To give it the low end, I'm not using the 10-inch speaker inside of this. I'm going down into the PRS cab below, which has a 12-inch speaker. What I'm using as well is because it's quite hard to get these sounds that were on these albums from back in the day, because the recording equipment was totally different, the mics were totally different. So I'm doing what I can to give you the same kind of vibe. You obviously can't get it exactly the same because you're not around in 1981. Marshall Astoria Classic, one of these new Marshalls. Fantastic amplifier, very much Hot Rod Plexi JSM100. That's been mixed sound for years. I'm using two of them at the same time because I can and I was allowed. What is quite cool though is on the album, everything is obviously double tracked. So what I've got on the Astoria is a DD3 set to a very, very quick slapback. So this is without. With. See, it's just behind it. You can't really tell the chords and stuff. But with these individual notes. And when paired with another amp that's just running dry. It sounds fantastic. So, that's the amps and that effect to give you that kind of faux double-tracked studio sound. Mick's been using double-tracked his entire career, and I will continue that effect throughout this entire video. It gets a bit more intense towards the end, but you'll have to wait for that. What he also used back in the day is a guitar that he notoriously didn't like, but he loved the sound of it, so I don't know why he used it. This is a 1972 Les Paul Custom. It's not. It's a Gibson Les Paul Custom. Mick's was a 1972. This is a fantastic beast of a guitar. Mahogany, maple top and back, mahogany neck, amazing pickups. It weighs a ton, but it sounds amazing. Nothing quite sounds as good as a fully dialed Les Paul Custom into a Marshall. Just ask Justin Hawkins. I've got to say now though, this Les Paul Custom belongs to my good friend, guitarist in Marco Mendoza's band and Tigers of Pantang, Mickey Crystal. There you go, it's a little plug for you, Mickey. It's a fantastic guitar. I could have got one of these through PMT, but Mickey's is nice and worn, just like it's from 1972. It's amazing. Check out Mickey's playing on Instagram and whatnot, because he's terrifyingly good. Mickey Crystal, he's very, very good. Anyways, that's enough about Mickey. Let's talk more about Mick and all the fun things I've got going on. Mick's rig is huge, like I said before, those refrigerators and stuff, but he didn't get those until later on. He's a big user of the Eventide H3000, which is a harmonizer unit where he gets that lovely chorus thick sound too, but again, we'll get to that later on. I've been told, well, I've read, that back in the early days, he used a 70s Boss chorus at all times, as a tiny little thing. It's a huge thing in the 80s to use a chorus at all times, just to kind of thicken it up a little bit. And that, with the double tracking, sounds great. What I've got, I'm going only through the Marshall, so there's double tracking through the Astoria, through the Marshall, is a Boss CE3 chorus ensemble with just a light little bit of chorus. So, this is it without chorus. And with a little bit of chorus. So it sounds like quite a lot, but when you pair them together, it sounds absolutely fantastic. Actually, let's play a little game. See if you can name all the Motley Crue riffs I play in this entire video. If you can name them all in the comments, I'll give you a pat on the bum and a kiss on the cheek. That'll be quite fun. So I've already played a couple. Let me know down below. What I've also got on the floor is an MXR 6-band EQ, the new little silver ones, because after listening to Too Fast for Love right now, doing this little video in the room I'm in with the amps in, it's a very pokey guitar sound, but not too pokey, hence the two amps. So what I've got is an MXR 6-band EQ with the lower mids kind of bumped up and the top end bumped up a little bit. I'll show you before and after with the doubler off. So this is before. With. So it kind of gives it a little bit more balls, doesn't it? So let's try and put all these together. So the doubler effect. This double track thing doesn't work all the time though. It's not too good for single notes. Gets a little bit mucky and a little bit confused. So, have it off for riffs like. And there's no clean channels on these amps. There wasn't any clean channels back in the day. No, no, no. You just use the volume control on his Les Paul. So, that's how I kind of got my too fast for low tone. Very gritty, very gnarly, it warms up. Well, now it warms up with lots of fire because we're coming here from hell. This is a good little segue into Shout at the Devil. Shout at the Devil, the second studio album by Motley Crue, came out in late 1983, I think. And live, to where they started to go a bit more intense than just a Marshall stack and a Les Paul custom. I do believe the album was recorded most on his Les Paul custom. I have read that somewhere on forums. Dude, the forums on Motley Crue stuff is pretty crazy because Mick's so secret about his stuff. It's kind of just going off what everyone kind of knows. But live, he started using Flying Vs. It's where the whole BC Rich Warlock thing kind of came in, because he's using these mad Warlocks and Nicky as well, in the Looks to Kill video, they're crackers. I used to look like I was in the Looks to Kill video, actually. It's very, very amusing. There's some fun pictures deep in my Facebook that no one's ever gonna see. I might have to hide them now so no one looks. But that's what we played live through his Marshalls. It sounded fantastic. A bit more low-end and grit, because it was produced a lot better to what the first album was. I hope it's coming through okay here. He's had a very signature sound for so many years with a doubler and a little bit of chorus, but there's a little bit more meat to it. So I've added a little bit more meat. And I'm gonna add a little overdrive pedal here and there to beef it up a little bit. I'm using the Strymon Riverside with a mid boost function just because I couldn't really find a tube screamer. And I really like the Riverside. And I'm in a guitar shop so I can do what I want. So I've boosted a little bit more of the low end on my MXR6 band EQ. Sounds nice and thick. I've turned off the chorus because sometimes there's not a lot of chorus and riffs like. But there's a little bit of overdrive on riffs like this. Without the overdrive, it sounds a little bit. Some of the fast chuggy stuff needs a little bit of a push. I'm not sure whether Mick just turned the gain up on his amp, had a boost pedal or what. I have seen a couple of pictures of an old Boss SD-1 kicking about, along with a tube screamer. Could be one of the two, could be one of his amalgamation of racks, which are slowly getting built up as time goes on. He's getting more and more Bradshaw gear. He's getting some crazy mods done to his J700s and his old plexis. It's great. What a time to be alive. It was awesome. So a lot of the stuff was done on Gibsons. I don't think it was recorded, like I said, on a lot of the Hamer, because he started using the Hamer Raj Explorer pointy guild things. It was mostly done on this, unless it was a song with a Floyd Rose in, and it's escaped me what he used. Anyways, we're moving nicely into my favorite territory. So with that same setting, he started using things like this, which are some of the best guitars ever made, in my humble opinion. Strats, one pickup, Floyd Rose, so we can do stuff like this. I'm gonna turn the chorus on, and a little bit of overdrive. There's literally, I'm on the low gain setting of the Strymon Riverside, and there's literally quarter of gain, if that makes sense. I'm about four of the gain scale. Turn the doubler off, because it sounds a bit daft. So, that was Shout with the Devil. Let's move over to where he got one of these, painted with the two theater mask faces, the happy and sad thing, onto the Theater of Pain era. 1985, Theater of Pain just came out. His tone hasn't really changed much, but his guitars have. He's still using the big yellow and black Hamer Explorer, but he's using more of these lovely buggers. Kramers. Kramers are great. I love Kramers, they're fantastic. This is a very, very old Beretta that I saved up a long time for. And if any Kramer fans are out there, it's been modded with a tone control. But I've seen a couple others with a tone control, and it's in a really awkward place. Is that original? Or was that on a special kind of model? I don't know, but anyways, mine has a volume and a tone control. It's a really, really old Seymour Duncan JB. When he went away from using his Les Pauls and stuff, and I believe his Les Paul is on the wall of the Hard Rock Cafe in Florida now, if you want to see that. And I think he just put his Warlocks and his Hamers in the bin, or sold them or something, because he wasn't really a big fan of them. Kramers, he started using Seymour Duncan pickups. He used 59s, JBs most prominently, and distortions. Great guitars. Mahogany necks? Rosewood necks on most of them. Big pointy headstock, they're great. One pickup. Berettas were a thing, Pacers were a thing. Pacers have more pickups. Berettas are the classic Van Halen thing, Floyd, slanted pickup. And when we move on to the next album, we'll get into the really, really fun Kramers. But for now, you use the Beretta. The tone is pretty much the same as it was on Shout of the Devil. But he played cool riffs like this. Sorry, that's just me fiddling, because I love this guitar. If you ever get a chance to play an old Kramer, do it, because they get a lot of stick for some reason. The new ones are amazing, but the old ones are just so, so good. Like, they've had loads of Eddie Van Halen and crew riffs and Twisted Sister riffs played on them for years. And if you get a really funky one like this, like a proper American one, the Schaller buttons say made in West Germany. West Germany was a thing when this was made. There was a wall. Crazy bit of history, man. And they're not very expensive as well. They're great. So, more Theater of Pain. Right, they were touring a lot. Home Sweet Home was a thing, and it blew everyone away with that lovely chorusy guitar sound. So let's have a little fiddle with that. Actually, in saying that, there's a lot more chorus in this song. I'm not gonna tell it because I'm still playing this bingo thing. So I have another chorus for this. I have an MXR analog chorus. It's another chorus that I consider to be very, very 80s because I don't have an Eventide H3000 harmonizer. So I've still got the CE5 going through the Marshall, the J700, I now have an MXR analog chorus going through the Astoria. Settings-wise, I haven't really discussed this because I keep tweaking it because each riff and stuff is slightly different depending on what you play, what amps you've got and stuff. So briefly, I've got the level quite low down on the CE5 with the depth and rate quite high up. So it's just kind of subtly in the mix. Opposite for the analog chorus, which is this guy. So the Theatre of Pain sound, very similar to the Shadow of the Devil sound, a bit thicker than the Two Coats for Loaves sound, but yeah, still very bitey, growly, like a chainsaw. Next album, Girls, 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 1987, August 1987, a couple of days after my girlfriend's birthday, and that is solely the reason why I'm with her. This chorus plays a crucial part in things like this. This is where the racks got big. He started incorporating other amps in. Everything went a little bit mad. Obviously the Girls, Girls, Girls tour blew everyone's minds. It was crazy. Mick started using Kramer Telecasters, which are rare as hen's teeth. And I'm using this, my platform on PMTV UK, to say, if you have a Kramer Telecaster, drop me a message on Facebook, Instagram, or whatever, Dagan Wilkin, and I will sell you my testicles. So I can have one of those Kramer Telecasters. Any of them. Anyways, I started using Kramer Telecasters. Black one and a white one. Black one, one Seymour Duncan JB, Floyd Rose, Girls, 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 and big pink letters. The other one, the white one, two pickups on the white one. Toggle switch in a weird place up here. Had red Girls, Girls, Girls written everywhere in what looked like lipstick, like the album cover. And both of them, when he flipped it around, had big boobs on the back. So, when he did this to the crowd, it looked like Mick had breasts, which is absolutely fantastic. Besides this, his rack gear grew more and more. He started using one of the most famous amps of the 80s, the Soldano SLO-100, which is essentially a modded plexi, but when paired with his modded J700s, gave that sound a lot of balls. Unfortunately for me, Soldanos are very expensive and very hard to find, especially in the UK. There's probably maybe half of one in the entirety of this year, England. So what I'm gonna do instead is turn up some of the bass, middle, and gain on the Astoria Custom, which is a little bit more ballsy, and maybe some of the bass and the treble on the J700s. And I'm gonna mess with the EQ a bit. So everything's running a little bit hotter, so I find that my Strymon Riverside is giving me a bit too much gain for what I need. So the Riverside is off for the moment, unless I want to do some leads. The chorus is still going through, the J700, the slight chorus, and there's still the doubler effect with the DD3 into the Astoria Custom. The big MXR chorus I had in the, like the intro to Girls, Girls, Girls is off. Sounds like this. Here's the thing, while playing that there riff from the opening of Girls, 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 my phone's been going crazy in my pocket because everyone knows what I'm doing tonight and everyone knows how much I enjoy this. I've just been sent this lovely picture of me from 10 years ago. Look at that hair, man. I've still got a lock around my neck. I don't wear a leopard print belt. I've still got those snakeskin cowboy boots. And it looks like I'm stuffing my pants as well. Surely not. Little kiddie digs with my handcuffs hanging from my zebra print belt. I'm sure I just got this tattoo as well. I thought I was cool as anything. And now I'm doing this and talking about these riffs, man. It's so cool. Thank you for watching. I'm not finished. I just wanted to say thank you. And let's play some more Crew. So back to the matter at hand. Mix, big ridiculous chorus. My MXR analog chorus does raise its head quite a lot in this album. Chorus is used more on this album. Well, the first time it's used a lot in Crew records. And the songs like... I don't think I've played that since that picture was taken. What I did there was put a little bit of delay on. In that song, there's lots of ethereal delays and stuff, so I thought I would add a DD7. Mick uses a bit of a delay, but more for a crazy effect. It's rarely used subtly. Think of like the crazy stuff he does these days with the wah and the Floyd and all that malarkey. So I now have a DD7 running through the J700 because I can, and I thought it fit really nice with that specific Crew song. So, girls, girls, girls. Kramer's pretty much exclusively those Telecasters with the boobs on the back, and JCM800 and a Soldano. The rig's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. He's starting to use things like big red things, which on that refrigerator picture is a voltage regulator. So, because obviously they've got loads and loads of money now, they can do what they want, they can tour these massive rigs around the world. It's a massive box, which essentially makes the amps run on not a lot of power to get the most out of them. It's awful for the amps, it kills them. But it sounds really good. So you can change the voltage of what's going through the amp. So instead of putting your plug in the wall, all the power is coming through and it makes it sound like however you want. He's starting to use these guys with his rack. It's getting more and more big. The sound's getting bigger than it's ever been. And the biggest Crew sound besides recently that I've heard is the Dr. Feelgood album. It's hard to play live. All of these are quite hard to play live because studio is a different thing to live. So I'm trying to do an amalgamation of them both to give you a Crew kind of what I think is more like mixed sound. On the Dr. Feelgood album, he went to work with Bob Rock, who's one of the best producers ever in the world, in history, ever. Google him, it's mental. And there's tons of guitar tracks on that album. The reason that album sounds so good, the reason the intro of Dr. Feelgood sounds so good, is that there's 14 guitars panned many, many different ways, which is really hard to do live and really hard to replicate, especially with the amps he had back at the time, because he was starting to use the Soldanos, the Marshalls, whatever Bob Rock had in his studio. I've heard the stories of AC30s and Fender Twins getting, screwdrivers through some of the speakers of a Fender Twin to make it sound distorted. All these things layered in to get the Dr. Feelgood sound, and all I've got now sound feeble having two Marshalls behind me after all this. That doubler and the chorus effect gives you a bit more balls. I'm going to give it a bit more bass end on the EQ and a bit more top end, maybe a bit middle on the amps to try and get you some Dr. Feelgood tones. I'm gonna go get some more. There's finally a war in the signal. So, Kickstart My Heart Solo has a war in, but what I was playing through there, well, get to the war in a second. What I was doing there was, in the intro, I had the doubler effect off because there's not two guitars, sounds weird going. Sound of a motorbike. So, turn that off and the riff, but in the main bit, I had the doubler on. Solo, doubler off, but introducing a wah. So, Nick now has a rack mount wah with little controllers all over the stage. People always say, why? What's a rack mount wah for? You can dial in your tone on the wah and just have, like I say, the controllers all over the stage. And one of the most crucial things about this is with the controllers, you haven't got to click the button on and off, so you just step on it. And it's good to go. So there's no clicking, there's no accidentally leaving it on. It is just purely rack wah. That's how Steve Vai gets to that. That thing. So, wahs are a big part. The Feel Good tour started. He's now using the Mirror Top Kramer Telecaster, which is my favorite. And again, if you have one of them, I'll give you both my nuts and these fingers, because I need these to play the guitar. So I have these ones. Yeah, you have my rings if you want. Great guitars. He has many, many amps now. He has, what is it again? Three Marshalls, two Soldanos, all running at the same time. There's places online now where you can buy the shells that he had them in for £1,000 for purely one of the shells of these amps. And they were all used and they were all on back in the day, mic'd up. The dude's sound was getting pretty crazy, but it was 1989. The Dr. Feelgood tour was around the world, and I wish I was alive in 1989. It would have been so cool to see. Berettas, the gear was still good, still tuned down a whole step, still maybe using 0.88 picks. It was cool. I don't know how they played that riff so drunk. It's crazy. I know we had a tech doing all his crazy switching and stuff, but man, that's a hard riff to play when you... It's a easy riff, but it's hard. It's hard to make it sound right. One of the songs where I think the doubler or the thick sound is most prominent, especially what he does now live, I'm gonna start slowly talking about what he does now live. He starts adding an octaver into his sound to give it a really thick sound, and there's a heavy chorus on pretty much everything, because he's a little bit ill, isn't he, Mick? I'm not gonna talk about that too much, but he's stiffening up a little bit, isn't he? So, live, he has a lot of octave on this song. Back in the day, it was all doubler, but I think it's very prominent on this tune. That's a thick ass song. It's only E and A for pretty much the entirety of. You've really got. Sounds mint. It sounds great. What I'm going to speak about next, I have to go and grab because I've forgotten it. It's this, a slide, and it can be heard on the tune that goes. Yeah. I like using the glass slide, even though I suck at slide, hence why I didn't play the riff. Mick Live uses a brass slide, but I've seen on the documentary, not the documentary, when he's doing stuff with Hinder, I think it is, and he's playing loads of riffs on his Strat, and there's loads of glass slides on the table. I assume the glass slides, it could be something more sinister, but they look like glass slides. So maybe he likes glass in the studio, and if you drop it live, it's not gonna smash, so. He wants to hear me do a really bad rendition of Without You. Nobody wants to hear that. So the 80s are now over. The Dr. Feelgood tour is in full swing. The guys were sober for an awfully long time if you've read The Dirt or if you've seen the movie, which isn't yet out yet. It's coming out like a week's time for me. That's why I'm doing this video. They're all sober. It was great. Then things started going dramatically downhill. Got a bit crap for them. They all started getting involved with certain bad things, having a little bit of a crap time through the 90s. And the 90s wasn't great for Crew, in my opinion. Big fan of Modern Crew, big fan of 80s Crew. The 90s, a little bit iffy. Decade of Decadence was their compilation album for their 10-year span. And 91 is where you first start seeing Mick play more Stratty guitars. He puts the Kramers out to stud, to eventually the Kramers now, which are lovely, lovely things. Buy yourself a Pacer, they're awesome. And he started playing Strats. First time you start seeing him play Strats. There's a couple of videos with PRSs as well, which are very funky things, and lots with Charvels. So, I have this lovely number to show you a couple of tunes. Charvel, Floyd Rose, Seymour Duncan, JB and the Bridge. That's all well and good, but what wasn't well and good is in 1994, Vince Neil left, and John Corabi, an amazing singer, joined Motley Crue as the frontman, and they released the album tentatively called Motley Crue. Bit weird. I love John Corabi, amazing singer, but not as the frontman of Motley Crue. That's Vince's job. So, tonally wise, it was a weird album because John played a lot of rhythm guitar on it. So, there's a lot of guitars happening, but not the usual Mick stuff that we all know and love. So, things. Not a lot of chorus going on. His sound's getting thicker and thicker in the 90s. They're bringing out more and more heavy gain amps, VHTs. Soldano's still a big part. The modern J700s are a big part. The big Marshall cabs, the Marshall stacks, with vintage 30s, I might add. He's always used vintage 30s. He's tried other things, but vintage 30s is where his heart lies. Playing Strats, playing Charvels. We're getting closer and closer to the guitar that we all know, which was 1996. But yeah, John Corabi was in the band. It was less of a glam rocky, chorusy double sound, and more of a classic rock band kind of. Still a lot going on, still very quintessentially Mick, but weird with John. So I'm gonna go over this into Generation Swine. So Generation Swine, 1997, Vince Neil is back fronting Motley Crue. John Corabi did a great job. The Motley Crue album, self-titled, was great. Not really Motley Crue in my humble opinion. Now Vince is back, that beautiful blonde bugger. Everyone can be happy. Guitar-wise is where it gets interesting because I believe this is the time where Mick solely started using 3 amps slaved out. I could be wrong, but before that, he kind of dilly-dallied with the idea and still loved a mic'd vintage 30 Marshall cabinet. So now, he has his modern Marshalls, JSM 800s. He had his Soldano SLO 100 and a VHT Bonehead, all getting slaved out, which means the power, well, the preamp tone section of each amp is getting slaved into separate power amps, which I believe are VHT as well, all getting controlled by that voltage regulator as well to push them extremely hard. They go through the preamp, sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself, to make them even louder. It's crazy. I think Mick says it's 124 decibels on stage when he plays, which is pretty crazy. A lovely, warm, thick sound, and Generation Swine and the next album, New Tattoo, is where the sound gets lovely, lovely, warm, thick, lovely warmness. Besides these amazing new amps in his refrigerator racks of joy with all his Yamaha gear, releases gear, and that lovely H3000 Eventide bugger, is where I can finally start talking about his main guitar, which he's used for all these years. Isabella is a 1996 Fender Custom Shop Stratocaster. It's not an original vintage one. He has got a cool one I'll talk about in a moment. But it's a 1996 Custom Shop one. It's great. I believe it's a single piece body. Lovely, massive 70s headstock, HSH configuration with pickups designed by JM Rolfe, who's an independent pickup designer from Kentucky. I've tried to get pickups through myself and I simply can't. He's running really high pickups at the time. It was 14K output on the bridge pickup, which is crazy. Not as in there's lots of distortion, but just the output is huge. It's like a square wave, but not unpleasant. JM Rolfe managed to wind them to 16 to 18K and put them in Isabella, his lovely white tortoiseshell Strat. Floyd Rose, one volume, two tones. The Floyd as well is weird. Normal Floyd, but sometimes you see it with little FU tone titanium saddles in. Quite a quirky little thing. Sometimes he has them, sometimes he doesn't. Personal preference. And what I like about it, it says Pimp on the back in big sparkly letters, besides all the rollicking. It's number two guitar besides that though. The Sunburst one that you see at the end of the Carnival of Sins tour is relict. No, is old and relict. It's pieced together from 1963, 4 and 5 Fender Strats. Rosa board, three-color Sunburst body, Zebra JM Rolfe pickups, Floyd Rose. It's amazing. There's loads of companies out there which kind of copy his guitar designs. LSL do some. Palmero Guitars made one for Nikki Sixx, which is amazing. But just get a nice Strat, that's what you need. I've still got the Charvel right now because he's still rocking Charvels. I did have an HSH Strat in to play with a Floyd Rose, but unfortunately, the perks of working in a guitar store, someone saw it and thought, that looks amazing, and bought it. So, I think I'm going to play an Ibanez next for the Generation Swine stuff. So, guitar-wise, what I have now, HSH Prestige Ibanez. Is it Prestige or Premium? Premium Ibanez. An Ibanez RG1070FM-NTL. Rolls off the tongue, just like a Fender Strat does. Tremolo, though, this is floating, though, unlike Mix, where all of Mix have always been on the top, so you can't pull back, they're not recessed, and they only go down. HSH, these have DiMarzio pickups in. Obviously, Mick had the JM Rolfs, but he realized in the early 90s, it's not just Seymour Duncan and DiMarzio and all that that make pickups. There's loads of other pickup builders out there. It's great, so yeah, difference is it hasn't got a maple board, but still sounds good though. Also, the overdrive is always on now because the sound is getting thicker and thicker. I've got to try and replicate those VHTs and the Soldanos and the Plexis all going through amps, which is a hard thing to do. But yeah. Notice as well, there was no chorus or double tracking because it was a lot thicker and beefier back then. The overproduced nature of music was kind of starting to come through with the new metal stuff and all the, all the bands of the late 90s. Really overproduced, thick sounds, not much time for like, I don't know. So that is kind of mixed sound to it is today. Overproduced. And every now and then he adds a little bit of flair here and there, like on the next album, New Tattoo, really, really overproduced. And let's see if I can still play this right. So there's a little bit of chorus there. Hell on High Heels, that song's called. And it brings back a little bit the old flair of the Eventide onto makes very overproduced sound now. So now his sound is everything blaring, doublers off, because it's not the 80s anymore, and it's not that kind of 80s sound. Like I keep saying, it's that overproduced sound. Chorus is always on. So I've got the mild CE5 going into this, and I'm gonna keep the analog chorus always on going into this, but dial back a bit, so it's not as intense as the intro to Girls, 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 but it's always there. If you're just gonna play these days, especially on the Ernie Ball String Theory series on YouTube, where he talks about his lovely paradigms and his thick-ass strings. Yeah, octaves in the mix, chorus in the mix. Yeah. When I was a kid, I never realized how to do that because Mix obviously got his rack mount wars, and I'm using a Crybaby original wah, which is spring-loaded and optical. So when you press on it, it springs back up to itself. Like I said earlier when I was playing the Steve Vai thing and whatnot, but it turns itself on. And the Saints of Los Angeles riff. I never knew how to get there. But I found out by these wahs. What I've done now is turn the main chorus off and the doubler on for the intro to this tune. And that, I think, is the end of my little rundown of what Mick used over the years, how his tones and guitars and amps evolved. Well, it's amps didn't evolve, they've just got more of them. And me trying to replicate it with the guitars that I have. But Mick's array of guitars is pretty crazy. He's got Isabella, his main Strat. I believe he gave the white Girls, Girls, Girls Telecaster away to his gardener. That's a fun story. The Les Paul Customs in the Hard Rock Cafe in Florida. And if any of you have any of them, let me know. I hope you enjoyed that though, a nice little video. I haven't spoken too much about settings and stuff. It's more just what the sound is in its own. There's no one quite like Mick Mars on this planet, and I don't think there ever will be. I'm really excited to see the dirt. In the dirt, it's quite interesting because they use some of the real guitars, but sometimes they don't. Like, they don't actually use a Gibson Les Paul Custom. They use an Epiphone Les Paul Custom with two pickups when the Epiphone blanked out on the headstock, which is a bit peculiar, but perfect for you guys out there that want to get this kind of tone on a budget. I'm using this crazy setup just because I can, because I was allowed to do this video and I'm in a guitar store, so I can. Things like the Boss Katana, when you USB them into a computer and you can manipulate the tone in such a way and save some presets, you're not going to be far off, and you haven't got to worry about having a HSH guitar, because Mick never really uses the neck pickup on his guitars. Some of the cool ones he used on the final tour, like the Seafoam Green and the red one with a matching headstock, totally relic, one humbucker, Floyd Rose, two single coils. Never really used single coils that much. Used a gold top at the end of the Carnival of Sins thing when they play Anarchy in the UK. That was cool. So I think I've squeezed everything Mick Mars and Motley Crue out of my brain to flam to you guys over YouTube. If I've forgotten anything or I've got any facts wrong, please let me know down in the comments, because I want to learn as much as you. I might have been lying about certain things, but just what I've read and what I've known. Mick's very secretive about his tone. We're all just kind of going through forums here to find out what's what. And Mick, if you're watching, good work. Good work. Great work. If you enjoyed all the riffs you've heard, comment down below every single one of them, and I'll give you a pat on the bottom, like I said, next time if I ever see you. And I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this again, because I've harped on for so long about certain things. You probably just want to hear guitar. I really hope this is translated well over YouTube through these Aston Stealths. Downtune your guitar whole step, get some cheap pedals together, chorus and overdrive, and you'll be there. essentially. You haven't got to have all of this. You've just got to have crew in your heart, and you'll be playing as good as Mick in no time. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like and subscribe to PMTV UK on YouTube for lots more cool music and guitar-related content. If you want any more information on any of the guitars I spoke about tonight, maybe some of the amps. If not, ring up your local PMT store and go, what's a Soldano SLO 100 and what can I get to sound like it? And they'll say, well, second hand, they sell for $2,500. And you go, Christ, can I have a Black Star instead? It sounds exactly the same. And they'll do that and you'll be very happy for £400. We are PMT House of Rock on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook. Be sure to give us a like and a follow to see lots of pictures of everything I've spoken about with cool filters on. I'm sure when the dirt comes out, we'll be sharing this and it'll be fun and everyone can either rip me to bits or enjoy it as much as I have. I've been Dagan. I'll be seeing you next time. Mickey, thank you for your Les Paul. And everyone out there, Kramer fans, what's this knob on my Kramer? Is it original? I don't know. Motley Crue! Yeah!